location, then we'll wander off.
Thank you. I will now tell you what I told the sixth form. We have been encouraged by the CDC, since we're outside and in a smaller company, appropriately dispersed, to take our masks off if we are vaccinated. So if you are vaccinated, you have that privilege. And if you aren't vaccinated, I hope you will be. And welcome. Welcome to everybody. I call upon the chaplain to ask the invocation.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we give you thanks for this wonderful, wonderful day. Be with us in our gathering together as family, friends, teachers, and administrators to celebrate the achievements of the St. James School class of 2021. Be with them as they go forth from these Fountain Rock grounds, weaving your truth into their lives. Be with them as they go out into the world, discovering their place within it. May they feel great excitement about the future. We pray that they will take their skills and gifts that we celebrate today and use them as leaders for good in the world. And may they always live lives of learning and discovery, and in doing so, bring great blessings to others throughout this world. This we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. Please be seated.
Again, welcome to everybody, especially a welcome to Bishop Eloff. We were reminiscing. Bishop Eloff was elected and consecrated in my third year, I think, or the end of my third year as headmaster, and during his time as diocesan, was very engaged in the school and a tremendous help to me personally as a very young headmaster. So honestly, it's always a little sentimental for me when you return to us, and I'm very grateful. And on behalf of the school, thank you for everything you have done for St. James and for the diocese. What a pleasure it is to have a proper commencement again. Although 15 of this class are still virtual and with us virtually, we hope. But you know, this commencement coincides with what we again hope will be the beginning, to use a Churchillian phrase, the beginning of the end of our COVID journey. And it has been indeed a remarkable 14 months, especially, you know, for everyone, but as we particularly have experienced it as a school. We were virtual, then hybrid, eventually three quarters of our students returning to campus, which required great effort on the part of our faculty, who, virtual teaching was completely new to us, very challenging. I think a little easier for my younger colleagues than those closer to my age. Then hybrid teaching, which I am assured is a kind of a nightmare. And then the way we had to stay on campus last spring as a community before we really knew how the virus spread, but safely here on campus doing our work and then returning as a whole community, cohorting, testing, all that work in the fall, staying together on campus through Thanksgiving, though we've discovered that the kitchen makes a terrific Thanksgiving dinner, so I don't know, you might lose your Thanksgiving vacation. It's pretty good. And then following COVID, you know, breaking at for Christmas, but coming back, losing spring break so we could, you know, get to this point earlier in the year, following the COVID, cohorting, testing, all of that, all those protocols, none of it was easy for the faculty, and they were incredibly conscientious and frankly brave to teach you and to be here for you, both virtually and in person. It's also been very difficult for our students, some sadly still virtual, 14 months virtual. others making great sacrifices to return to school, particularly those coming from abroad where they had to, you know, our Chinese students had to quarantine 2 weeks, sometimes 3 weeks in a different country, a third country, in order to return to us. Others staying, like Coco did this, stayed in America with the Farrells all the way through the summer so that she could be here as senior prefect for this year. And then, you know, quarantining, you know, and the whole experience that we had here on campus, our protocols, our cohorting and social distancing, explaining to parents sometimes on a daily basis that they could not visit us. You have no idea how, maybe you do know, how difficult it is to tell parents they can't visit their children. Imagine that. But, you know, that's how we as a community had to function. And that was extremely hard on parents as well. But that's kind of what the rules required us to preserve in-person learning for our students. You know, fewer breaks and really no visits home until the end, and no interscholastic sports until later in March. None of our usual outings or activities. Not the usual sort of salad bar in the dining room. You kind of, in the early days, you ate what you were served. And, you know, acting and singing and practicing with social distancing and masks on. Not easy. I sang with the choir for lessons and carols, and I have to tell you, it was brutal. I had no idea that was so hard. I almost fainted, and I lost my voice for about a week. It's just, it wasn't easy. And I shared with the sixth form a great truth that I will now share with all of you. Throughout this entire year, they never, at least those here on campus, never once complained to me. Not once. And I've never had a year where the sixth form did not complain to me. That's extraordinary. As guys, I shared with them, it's sort of the time of life to complain. I don't know if parents have noticed this, but teenagers can be a little whiny at times. And not this year, not at all. They've gained that greater gratitude and that better perspective. Our staff, for their conscientious attention to the refectory and cleaning protocols, getting here early in the morning and spraying and wiping and all the work that they've had to do to keep the campus safe for all of us. Administrators adapting and planning. I told, true to form, I fled to Maine for a couple of weeks this past summer, and Mr. Batson was constantly calling me up with a new plan, and I would say, just go to sleep on it. It'll be different tomorrow. Don't worry about it. And, you know, because you have an idea, and then the rules would change, and you'd have to come up with a new one, and everybody expecting answers when we had no answers to give. But I really particularly want to thank Mr. Batson, Mr. Latchett, Ms. Sherman, Mr. Weivel, who've really had to do a great deal of behind the scenes and, frankly, upfront administrative leadership and support. And that has really been a great gift to us all. Finally, I would like to thank Mrs. Swaby, who arrived, you know, for her first year as school nurse in the middle of a pandemic. Welcome to St. James. You know, and all the, you know, her excellent crew of nurses who joined and helped her, Maria and everybody else. It's the testing and the coordinating with Meredith. Our thanks to Dr. Joshi, who really was our guy on the inside there, and we had just tremendous support and expert advice all the way through as we responded to the pandemic. But, you know, then the vaccinations, first for the faculty, and then 18 and up students, and 15 and up, and, you know, their long hours and their additional duties. I don't think it was at all what you signed up for, but the hope is that the subsequent years will be easier. But I am to predict that the sixth formers will start whining again. That will return, so get ready for it. Whoops, I shouldn't have said that. God got me for that. Then the gifts of COVID. What I shared with the sixth form in chapel, what I think we have gained with this experience, and they are these: humility. An acknowledgement that we have as, you know, very privileged people in the most powerful country on earth, that guess what, we're not in charge of everything as we once thought we were. And frankly, shame on us for thinking that we were. We're not. That's why we believe in God, and why we need our neighbor to love us, and why we need to love our neighbor and put our neighbor first. also a better sense of set of priorities, kind of what's important and what isn't important. Maybe playing that season, we can wait a year on that until it's safe to return to the court or to the playing field. A better attitude of gratitude and appreciation, and also of empathy of what, you know, this tremendous threat has meant to so many more people who are so much more vulnerable and at risk than we are. And let us hope that we can hold on to these gifts as we go forward and as you go forward to live your life beyond us. Today is the Feast of Pentecost, in which the Church celebrates the coming of the Holy Spirit and at the Feast of Pentecost in Jerusalem, and the Spirit's gifts of courage and resilience, and the gift of resilience to which Mr. Latchett spoke yesterday at Baccalaureate. And this is what we have seen this past year and what we believe in here, what we celebrate with the prizes that we will give today, this morning. That life requires courage and resilience, humility, gratitude, and faith. And this is what the St. James journey requires, preparing you for life. Because if you're going to journey happily and safely and successfully here for 5, 4, 3, 2 years, you need to learn how to make new friends and really deep friendships with people who are different from you. You need to try new things and get out of your comfort zone, finding new interests and passions in areas where you aren't the expert already. You need to fail, and you need to improve. You need to apologize, and you need to grow up. And not being the star all the time and not always getting what you want is an important part of that process. That's what we believe here. And sadly, you can go to other places and pretty much get what you want all the time. But St. James does not think that's educating and formational, most of all morally. And also at Pentecost, we celebrate the Church, those many tongues and nations that come together to form the body of Christ. And you have had that experience here as a school, many tongues and nations reflected in this class, and really coming together so closely this year as you have been on campus together. Our tremendous and valuable diversity, the deep friendships which cross boundaries because we live in community so closely together. As all of you have done, this is a wonderful class. This, and especially this group that has really bonded here on campus. At our meeting on Monday, after the prefect vote, I always meet with the sixth form, and I explain to them the annual fund. And, oh, this might be helpful. I'm explaining to you the annual fund, too. And the annual fund is the way in which our alumni and our parents and our past parents and our friends support us on an annual basis, allowing us to afford over $1 million more in financial aid than we would otherwise be able to afford, and more expensive programs like football teams and musicals. So I'm explaining this and how important it is to the class, and I said to them, just because the spirit moved me, can any of you do a better job of this than I can? And of course, Jacob Dugas got up and did a much better job than I did. And then, you know, everybody, I think, Francine, were you next, right? I mean, it was wonderful, about 10 of them. And I could tell it could keep going. And I turned to Mrs. and just, you know, I received that aid, or my friends received that aid, or this has been such a great experience, and we need to give and we need to support it. Again, in 29 years, I have never experienced that. And that's you, that's who you are. But it's how you bonded with each other and with this school, and on a personal basis with me. So thank you very, very much. I told Mrs. McQuiggan, I said, I've got to leave because I'm going to go home and cry. And she came in the next day to check on me to make sure I was all right. It was just incredibly moving. You are indeed more powerfully bonded with each other, your teachers, and this school. And you will always remember that you were the COVID class. We have a class that graduated during the Spanish flu that greeted me when I came, and they were a remarkable class. They always came to alumni weekend, and they would remember the experience of going to the chapel on their own to pray for their classmate Lucius Kellum, who was dying of the flu in the infirmary. And miraculously, while they were in chapel, his fever broke and he began to heal. And they never missed Sunday chapel on alumni weekend. They were always right there in the front pews weeping at Mass. They never forgot that. And Lucius Kellum himself, you may notice that the auditorium is named for him because he gave the gift. He also built the bridge that, across the bay on the Virginia side that connects with Virginia. That's the Kellum Bridge. So a leader for good in the world. So you are that class. You have that opportunity. You have learned those lessons. You have discovered those passions. You have found that power. Go out and do great good. Amen. It is customary to award scholastic prizes in recognition of achievement in the various subjects as evidenced by highest grades. These were awarded on prize day as follows. The following middle school students received prizes on prize day, Friday, May 21st. The middle school headmaster's prize was awarded to Jeremiah Davian Gorham of Bristow, Virginia. The prize for excellence in religion was awarded to Robertson Jack Ashby Jacobs of Ontario, Canada. The Rich Memorial Prize for the highest GPA in the middle school was awarded to Yushan Iris Lee of Beijing, China. The prize for excellence in Latin was awarded to Evie Cassidy Browner of Hagerstown, Maryland. The prize for excellence in history was awarded to Minjie Daniel Liu, Hangzhou, China. The Reichard Middle School Science Prize was awarded to Juliana Janet Rodriguez of Hagerstown, Maryland. The prize for excellence in English was awarded to Mia Giselle Alvarez of Lafayette, Louisiana. The prize for excellence in mathematics was awarded to Yushan Iris Lee of Beijing, China. The Marianne Hatcher Memorial Prize for love of learning and care for fellow students, given by her father George Hatcher, class of 74, and to a second former, was awarded to Valerie Diane Zumbrum, Myersville, Maryland. The following fourth form students received prizes on prize day. The Waller Wynn Prize for non-Western history and culture was awarded to Sophia Wan Yue, Bristol, Lanham, Maryland. The Clarence W. Wheelwright Prize for devotion to duty, endowed by Dr. and Mrs. Gallier of Baltimore, was awarded to Danse Kanuche Yanu, Laurel, Maryland. The Tim Shryock Prize for willingness to serve, endowed by Tim's mother, Mrs. Shryock, was awarded to Ezra William Burdett of Brownsville, Maryland. The following fifth and sixth form students received prizes. The prize for excellence in English, endowed by Mr. Richard Turner, given in memory of Russell and Wilhelmina Nelson, and the prize for excellence in Latin, were awarded to William Alexander Zimmerman, Hagerstown, Maryland. The prize for excellence in Spanish, given in honor of George C. Belden, longtime master of St. James School by the class of 1959, and the prize for excellence in biology, were awarded to Jaka Provodnik Kran, Slovenia. The Henry Kidd Douglas Prize for English Composition was awarded to Jackson Giordano Pentany, Shepherdstown, West Virginia. The Bowman Byron Fine Arts Prize was awarded jointly to Warner Thompson James III, Hagerstown, Maryland, and John Matthew Weisgerber, Frederick, Maryland. The Prize for Excellence in Art, endowed by Mrs. Elizabeth R. McLeod, was awarded to Nash Richard Pena, Shepherdstown, West Virginia. The prize for excellence in physics was awarded to Yui Yan Yanni Gao, North Bethesda, Maryland. The prize for excellence in European history was awarded to John Matthew Weisgerber, Frederick, Maryland. The prize for excellence in music, endowed by Robert W. Grab in memory of his father, Charles L. Grab, and his mother, Elizabeth P. Grab, was awarded jointly to Allie Nicole Jacobson, Hagerstown, Maryland, and William Alexander Zimmerman, Hagerstown, Maryland. the United States History Prize endowed by Mr. Sims A. Jamison, longtime friend of St. James School, was awarded to Huxi Jesse Wan, Tianjin, China. The Prize for Excellence in Mathematics and the Prize for Excellence in French were awarded to Piho Michael Lau, Hong Kong. The Prize for Excellence in Chemistry in memory of Dr. Marion Vesey, endowed by Mrs. Vesey, was awarded to Audrey Alexandra Johnson, Frederick, Maryland. The John C. Campbell Memorial Prize for the Most Improvement in Oral Communication while at St. James was awarded in the fifth form to Daniel Paul Peacher, Hagerstown, Maryland, and in the sixth form to Ji-hyun Katie Kwan, Seoul, South Korea. The St. Lawrence Book Award is awarded in recognition of the value that the St. Lawrence community places on service to others, honoring the achievements of a high school junior who has displayed a significant commitment to community service. This year, the award was presented to Josephine Edwede Ogor Ahibe, Lagos, Nigeria. The Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute Award, given to a fifth former who is an outstanding math and science student who demonstrates potential for success in a science or technology-related profession, who demonstrates consistent achievement in testing performance, and who adheres to rigorous academic standards, was awarded this year to Sungbum Lee, Yongji-do, South Korea. The State of Maryland Merit Scholastic Award certificates were presented, I'm allergic to mulch, so you just know you know what that is, to Puyi Ho Michael Lau, Hong Kong, Yaka Provodnik Kran, Slovenia, and Xiyui Coco Zhang, Shanghai, China. I have some water. And it is just water. There's a great joke about a young priest who's told to drink during his homily to make them more interesting, and he makes the mistake of drinking gin instead of water, so he has a different chat with his rector after that sermon. On Thursday, April 19th, certificates of membership in the St. James chapter of the Cum Laude Society were given in the fifth form to Yuxing Lin Chen, Dokyung Oh, Camilla Maria Power, Heishu Jesse Wang, Jihan Annie Zhao. In the sixth form to Rachel Emily Lavazer, to Laurel Josephine Henriette Maubert, to Yaka Provodnik, to John Matthew Weisgerber, and William Alexander Zimmerman. Leo Castro Cucuzella, Puyi Ho Michael Lau, Nash Richard Pena, Shi Yi Coco Zhang, and Yin Emily Zhu were elected members in their fifth form year. Congratulations. I now introduce to you our commencement speaker. Malik Joshi serves as the president and CEO for Meritus Health, which is, you know, our whole health system out here in central Maryland and in the tri-state area. With more than 3,000 employees and 500 medical staff members, Meritus includes Meritus Medical Center, a 300-bed regional hospital that is magnet-recognized, Meritus Medical Group, an enterprise of 100 providers and growing, and Meritus Home Health. Meritus Health is also a 25% owner of Maryland Physicians Care, a 220,000 Medicaid member health plan. The mission of Meritus Health is to improve the health status of our region. Prior to Meritus Health, Dr. Joshi was the Executive Vice President of Integrated Care Delivery and Chief Operating Officer for the Anne Arundel Health System, a regional health system headquartered in Annapolis, Maryland, that serves an area of more than 1.2 million people. Previously, Dr. Joshi served as the Associate Executive Vice President at the American Hospital Association and President of the Health Research and Educational Trust. He has also served as Senior Advisor at the Agency for Healthcare Research and Quality, President and CEO of the Delmarva Foundation Vice President at the Institute of Healthcare Improvement, Senior Director of Quality for the University of Pennsylvania Health System, and Executive Vice President for the HMO Group. Dr. Joshi has a doctorate in public health and a master's in health services administration from the University of Michigan, and a bachelor of science in mathematics from Lafayette College. He was editor-in-chief for the Journal for Healthcare Quality. He also co-edited the healthcare quality book, Vision, Strategy, and Tools, and co-authored Healthcare Transformation, a guide for the hospital board member and leading healthcare transformation, a primer for clinical leaders. Dr. Joshi is an adjunct faculty member at the University of Michigan School of Public Health in the Department of Health Management and Policy, and annually teaches a course in their executive master's program. Dr. Joshi has served on numerous not-for-profit boards, including our own, within and outside healthcare, including most recently as governor, appointed commissioner on the Maryland Community Health Resources Commission. I had the honor and the privilege and the opportunity of serving on the search committee that appointed Dr. Joshi as CEO, and he was my candidate from the beginning. I can honestly say, I can also say, by the way, the same thing to you, Bishop Eloff. You were my candidate from the beginning. And it was just so exciting that we were going to gain a CEO who had this public health experience and expertise and wisdom. Little did we know that we would experience just a year later all that we are, have experienced. And he has led basically our county and our region's response to COVID, which has been extraordinary. We had, they figured out treatment and medication and protocols that brought our mortality rate dramatically lower than the rest of the state and other places. They brought in the vaccine program aggressively very early on, which was, of course, a great benefit to this school, first for our faculty and then for our students. They've just been avant-garde and in front and highly effective in their response to the pandemic, and I frankly credit his leadership for that remarkable response. So even before he speaks to us, thank him. It's been very well done. And then finally, he did agree in a deal. He made me agree to serve on the board for, they created another term so that I and two others could serve. So I agreed to do that, but he agreed to come onto our board, and that was extremely timely as well. He is a graduate of Lawrenceville School, so he knows what these kind of schools are like. Malik.
Good morning, everyone, and thank you, Father Dunnan. What a privilege to be here to celebrate with the class of 2021 and your parents and the faculty. It's a special day, special event, and I congratulate you. So I wanted, before I get into just a couple of minutes of thoughts, I wanted to give you a couple of context of when I had two other occasions to speak at a really celebration. So about 15 years ago, I gave the commencement address to University of North Texas Health Science Center in Fort Worth, Texas. School of Medicine, School of Public Health, Allied Health School, a few hundred people. So I got down to Fort Worth a couple days before, gave a number of talks, and I lost my voice the night before the commencement. Never happened before, perhaps the weather change or such. So I remember, though, a good commencement speech is a short commencement speech. So it worked out fine. I don't think it was memorable. I'm pretty sure it wasn't audible, but it was completed. Now, 20 years ago, I was fortunate to give a toast as a best man to my college roommate's wedding in England. And he was saying, it's no big deal. You know, you're gonna follow my father-in-law. And he's a little bit of a wild card. So you'll be perfect right after him. Keep it short, you know, do the usual. So I didn't think it was a big deal, but apparently toasts in England are big deals. So I was ready to go, I had a couple minutes. I didn't, you know, prep too much, but the father of bride gives his toast, and it's a 15-minute soliloquy. And at the end of it, he pulls out from underneath the table a big 3-foot teddy bear that he had given to his daughter 30 years ago and passing it on to my roommate, John, as a passing of the baton. Not a dry I in the house, as you can guess. You know, I gave my speech, it was fine. Later at the reception, when they were lining up for autographs with him, people would come up to me and say, you know, with a hand on your shoulder, which we could do back then, and, you know, a nod and say, you know, that was nice. So it was nice. Here's my third charm, right? So this is it. So first of all, I just want to say, you know, a lot has happened, and you are the COVID class, and it's special. It's life-altering for many of us, but it does mean a lot. It's something we can't talk about, but I want to talk about some of the things that we've learned because of the last year. We've learned a lot, so I'm going to talk about three. The first one is lots of us learn new skills, right? So people would tell me they learned a new cooking dish, they spent more time with their woodworking, they did new arts and crafts, they learned new things. I took the time, in addition to watching Netflix, to also learn a new language. So the language I learned is the fastest growing language in our country, and that's a language of teenagers, Gen Z lingo. So like all of us, you know, you start learning it, and I'm going to share with you kind of an example of how far I've come along in Gen Z lingo in a conversation with Father Dunnan. So Father Dunnan and I talking about vaccinating the sixth formers at St. James. Father Dunnan says to Malik, "Malik, the state has now opened vaccinations for 12 and older. Can we get the St. James kids in line to get the COVID vaccine?" Malik, "Bet." Father Dunnan, "Do I have to bet?" Malik, "Sorry, Father Dunnan, I meant yes. Getting the six formers all vaccinated by graduation, that would be straight fire." Father Dunnan, "I thought it was just a needle. Is fire involved?" Malik, "Sorry, I meant that it would be great. In addition, I know I occasionally flex on my Finsta, but we are so fast in vaccinating. No cap." Father Dunnan, "Remember to always stretch before you flex." Malik, "Good advice, Father Dunnan. I will. Also, I don't want to spill the tea, but we are pretty darn good in this area." Father Dunnan, "You might be, just don't throw too much shade." Malik, "Father Dunnan, high key, we have to get a high vaccination rate." Father Dunnan, "Hundo P?" Malik, "100% would be Gucci." Malik, "Father Dunnan, by the way, can I tell you how lit it is for me to be associated with St. James? You are the goat." Father Dunnan, "Big oof. Sometimes you are extra, Malik." Malik, "TBH, I can be aux." Father Dunnan, period T. So, again, I'm not saying I've learned a lot or a valuable skill, but we all have to learn. I think that's one of the things we really have to take back. We learned so many things over this past year out of our comfort zone, different than what we may have thought. But that learning will keep you going for your lifetime. Now, COVID is real. You know, I can't speak enough about how much it's altered so many of our lives. A friend of mine's father-in-law, 90 years old, never in the hospital. He got COVID and passed away in 2 weeks. He and his wife could only see the funeral by Zoom because only 9 people could be at the funeral. Someone was in our hospital, a 50-year-old gentleman, never really sick in his life, got COVID, went on a ventilator, recovered, and discharged 50 days later from the hospital recovering. You know, we have a unit for COVID patients that's fortunately on the ground floor. And we have people talking to their loved ones through the window because they can't go in and visit. They are putting planters outside the window. They're putting balloons outside the window. They're putting up posters and signs. They're having their dogs talk and see them through the windows. They're sitting there. It's real, it's devastating, and it's decimated so many of our lives. But the two other things I really want to talk about in terms of learning from COVID is abundance and agility. Very simply, we do have a lot, and we can do a lot with what we have. So let's start with abundance. Yeah, because of the pandemic, We had less. We felt like we had less. We had less going out, less being able to see our grandparents, less being able to go out to the ballparks, less of so many things, less toilet paper. But if you think about what we could do with what we have, we made it happen. We all started talking about masks. Everybody started making masks, tons and tons of masks. In healthcare, we have these special N95 masks. And working with our communities and our stakeholders, we kept getting more and more. As hard as they are to find, we got them. And when the rubber bands on the masks were old and breaking apart, we had people coming into our hospital every day sewing these rubber bands onto the masks. Just community individuals sitting in our atrium sewing day after day after day. We have a lot, and we got it done. When we needed face shields, we had schools and others making them out of 3D printers. Coming in early in the morning, staying late at night, 3D printers aren't meant to manufacture tons and tons of things. But that's what we did. We made it happen with what we had. A lot of us didn't get a chance to see our families, right? But we started having more Zoom calls. On Sundays, we had Zoom calls, and we got to see people in our family that we hadn't seen, actually, in a while. We got to see more people. We had more conversations. It was not physical, but there was emotional abundance. Before the pandemic, we would run around a lot. We would get errands done. We would go to the games. We might stay late for work. We might go out with friends. During the pandemic, there were more and more dinners around the table with our families, more opportunity to reflect on the day, to talk about the day, and talk about lives. Abundance. Businesses, communities, we all came together. We chipped in when we need to. And even though there might have been physical scarcity, there was emotional abundance. From the perspective of abundance, we did, and we will continue to take care of each other. Abundance, so we have a lot. What do we do with it? That's where agility comes in. Your teachers were agile. Thank you to the faculty. I hope you thank them all the time. In the past, we would think about new things to do. We'd put together a committee. We'd plan it out. We'd try it. We'd see how it works. We'd try it again. 12 months later, we might have something. If we were really fast, maybe 6 months. Because of the pandemic, months turned into days and hours. On a pivot, your teachers went to virtual and hybrid and other learnings and other teachings. We worked as fast as we could so the value was there for you. Businesses, who I feel so much for, they went as fast as possible. If they couldn't eat in the restaurant, they figured out how to deliver, how to do curbside, how to do delivery. We used a lot of plexiglass. They figured out everything they could to be there for their customers. Agility. Father Dunn talked about COVID, and testing for COVID is one of the best ways to prevent any disease. Testing will help you to identify contained spread of disease. 14 months ago, we started testing as fast as we could. What did we do? We just put a couple of small tents in the back of a building, and we said, if you can drive up, we'll swab your nose, we'll test in our lab, we'll give you a result. And we built and built that. When it got hot, we put out fans out there for our healthcare heroes. When it got cold, we decided to put a couple of trailers underneath a wedding tent. And in the heyday, 1,000 cars a day would go through to get testing. 140,000 tests we have done here in our community in the last 14 months. It's amazing. It's because we were agile. It's because we knew we never would have thought of this place. We never thought of this process, but we had to do this for our community. That's agility. So whether it's by Zoom, by WebEx, by new ways, by new approaches, we were agile. So as we move forward, we have what we need. Think about abundance. We know how we can do it. Think about agility. And let's keep making it better. Think about learning. The last thing I'll end you with is, people have asked, what has gone from COVID that you would view as a silver lining? And there's lots of great comments. I just want to read you a few from our world. Somebody said, I got to know my neighbors better. Somebody said, practicing being grateful for what I have. Somebody said, I wash my hands more. I like that one. Somebody else said, we have been able to save more money than we ever did. More personal reflection, more compassion, more empathy. Less commuting time, less traffic time, more time at home. I've had a time to take a step back and see what is actually important in my life. More reflection, more compassion, and more empathy for each other. So none of this is to minimize the impact of COVID, but we've learned a lot. And I ask you, as you move forward in the next phase, first of all, enjoy your day. Enjoy the time. Thank your family. Keep learning. And approach life with a lens of abundance. You have been given a gift of abundance from St. James. You have been able to see abundance in the form of friendships, abundance in the form of what you've learned from your teachers, abundance in the form of what you've learned from your textbooks, abundance in the form of the people you interact with every day and serve, and abundance from the values you live. Use that abundance and use it with agility. Congratulations to class of 2021. A special time. Thank your families and enjoy your next phase. Thank you.
Malik, thank you very much. And don't worry, I didn't miss his talk. I got to read it ahead of time. So wind and mulch are not a happy combination for me. I apologize. Non-scholastic prizes are awarded to members of the student body who during their years at St. James made noteworthy contributions to the life of the school or who have exhibited outstanding qualities of leadership and such characteristics as integrity, cooperation, loyalty, and seriousness of purpose. Most prizes are awarded on the basis of a two-thirds vote of the faculty, which is really remarkable. And prizes, by the way, are not always awarded. The faculty have to agree on the candidate, and otherwise we don't award the prize. The Onderdonk Headmaster's Prize, endowed by Mr. and Mrs. Richardson Onderdonk, class of 1935, in memory of Henry Onderdonk, headmaster of St. James School from 1869 to 1895, and Adrian Onderdonk, headmaster from 1903 to 1939, is awarded to that member of the sixth form who has served the wider community beyond St. James School, well beyond the school's expectation or requirement. It is awarded this year to Jessica Junyang Gung, Beijing, China, in absentia. The G. Dudley Acker Award is given to that sixth former who during his or her years at St. James has overcome adversity and has achieved a measure of success. This award has been made possible through gifts from Dudley, his classmates and friends, and is awarded this year to Rachel Emily Lavazer, Hancock, Maryland. The Chaplain's Prize is awarded by the chaplain to that student who best best exemplifies the primal purpose of St. James School in training young people for lives of Christian witness and devotion, as shown by faithful attention to church life, courteous consideration of other people, and a high sense of personal integrity. It is awarded this year to Jacob Gerald Duga, Ontario, Canada. The Sims A. Jamison Prize, endowed by Mr. Jamison to the sixth former who has shown the most improvement in his or her years at St. James, is awarded to Vincent Kwasi Mawunyo Joseph Anani, Greater Accra, Ghana. The A. Smith Bowman Prize to that sixth former whose consistently polite, kind, and gracious behavior sets the standard for his peers and benefits the society of the school. Awarded this year to Omotade Adewale Omoshore, Osun State, Nigeria. The Margaret Aiken Pennington Prize, given by Mr. and Mrs. William Pennington, Jr., class of 1970, in memory of Margaret Pennington, longtime librarian and advisor to the first class of girls at St. James, to that sixth former, whose consistently polite, kind, and gracious behavior sets the standard for her peers and enhances the society of the school, it is awarded this year to Venus SNM Anani, Greater Accra, Ghana. The Charles G. Meehan, Jr., class of 65, prizes for all-round athletic ability in the sixth form are awarded to Morgan Francis McMahon, Hagerstown, Maryland, and Jacob Gerald Duga, Ontario, Canada. Pages got blown open. Okay, here we go. The David I. Barr Prize for Sportsmanship and Leadership in Athletics is awarded to Lauren Elizabeth Aguila, Shepherdstown, West Virginia. The Class of 1950 Award for Creativity, supported by the Class of 1950 Fund, is given to that member of the sixth form who has shown him or herself to be creative and original through a significant achievement or work which enlivens the spirit of the school. This achievement or work can be in any field, academic, artistic, dramatic, musical, or athletic. And it's interesting because obviously something artistic or dramatic or musical, even athletic, is kind of more obvious when you look at a creativity prize. And that's typically the way this prize has gone on, probably mostly to artists, sometimes then maybe musicians and actors and athletes. But this year, it's going to a sixth former for his academic leadership and his just love of learning in languages that has really has just enlivened that whole side of our program. And it goes to William Alexander Zimmerman, Hagerstown, Maryland. And that really is the first time in my memory that it's gone for an academic creativity, so well done. The school prize is given on occasion by the headmaster. So this one's for me. This is the one I get to give. It's always ironic that I don't get to give the headmaster's prize, but I do give the school prize. To a member of the sixth form who, in his opinion, which is say my opinion, has shown faithful devotion to St. James School, it is awarded this year to Ian Bullitt Stimson, Falls Church, Virginia. The Mary Latrobe Onderdonk Memorial Prize for Sound School Citizenship is awarded to Jacob Gerald Duga, Ontario, Canada. the 50th Anniversary Alumni Award, initiated by the class of 1928, to that sixth former who exhibits outstanding leadership ability, is awarded to Xie Yu Coco Zhang, Shanghai, China. The MacLeod Prize, in memory of Dr. and Mrs. Colin MacLeod, endowed by Mrs. MacLeod and her daughter Mary Woodruff, to that member of the sixth form who by high ideals, faithfulness to duty, earnest endeavor, and sound character has made a contribution worthy of praise. It is awarded this year to Ji-hoon Katie Kwan, Seoul, South Korea. The Trustees Prize, given in recognition of the highest GPA in the upper school maintained over a two-year period, is awarded to Pui Ho Michael Lau, Hong Kong, in absentia. The Moulton Profecit Prize, in memory of Dr. Lawrence Hoyer, endowed by his wife Phyllis Hoyer, is awarded to that member of the sixth form who, with broad interests and with participation in a wide range of activities, has achieved in all a commendable success, is awarded this year to Warner Thompson Jimmy James III, Hagerstown, Maryland. The Centennial Prize, in memory of Evelyn Richardson Onderdonk, to that member of the sixth form who has made an outstanding contribution to the immediate general welfare of the school along one or more lines, is awarded to Morgan Francis McMahon, Hagerstown, Maryland. The Headmaster's Prize, which again is awarded by the faculty, to that member of the sixth form who best exemplifies the qualities of a scholar as evidenced by his or her academic success, enthusiasm for learning, and positive engagement in class discussion. It is awarded this year to Jaka Provodnik, Kranj, Slovenia. Jaka is another great linguist, and he picks up languages for fun, like a classmate of mine when I was growing up. The Bishop's Prize, by tradition the school's highest prize and greatest honor, is awarded to that member of the sixth form, and I'll ask Bishop Beloff if he would come forward to give it, to that member of the sixth form who during his or her time in the school has contributed most to the long-range, long-term welfare of the school, either by accomplishment or by personal example. It is awarded this year to Xiyu Coco Zhang, Shanghai, China. If the members of the graduating class will please come forward. It's time. Bella, you look confused. No, you're graduating. Jeff, if you'll take the middle, Bishop, you'll be that side, and then I'll come join you.
On which side?
You should be at the end, so it's like halfway down, maybe. Okay. By virtue of the authority vested in me by the Board of Trustees, you have been found qualified for suitable recognition through award of the school diploma or the promise. Actually, you're all graduating, so the award of the school. And I have asked Mr. Batson to read the name, so I'm not going back and forth. I learned 2 years ago at commencement that was not good for me, so I will come and be with you.
For 28 years of boarding school, I've wanted this power. I really have. And the other thing, guys, shame on you. COVID to keep your parents away? That's what you told them? Oh, my goodness. My son came up with better excuses than that. Lauren Elizabeth Aguila. Samuel Oluwafemi Akerewusi. Indiana will never be the same. Isaac Olakunle Akinye. Venus Essenham Anani. Vincent Kwesi Moyunyo Joseph Anani. Miguans Assange Goulet in absentia. Isabella Ann Botner. Reagan Grace Bradley. John Edward Charlton in absentia. Ege Jimak in absentia. Leo Casto Cucuzella, cum laude. Francine Dayanara Diaz Bonilla. Jacob Gerald Dugas. Hey.
You did it, Mom and Dad.
Jessica Junyan Gun in absentia. Lucas William George. Lin Khan Emma Hyun in absentia. Allie Nicole Jacobson. Warner Thompson Jimmy James III. Doris Javid. Yim Young Chloe Jung in absentia. Isaiah Joseph Benjamin Knight in absentia. Jihyun Katie Kwan. Pui Ho Michael Lau, cum laude, in absentia. Pui Ming Philip Lau, in absentia. Rachel Emily Levasser, cum laude. Yuin Chuan Oliver Lee, in absentia. Laurel Josephine Henriette Molbert, cum laude. Morgan Francis McMahon. Haviland Baba Mercer. Evan Ndehiro. Nok Wong Bao Jennifer Nguyen in absentia. Min Koi Nguyen in absentia. Luke Daniel Norris. Omotade Adewale Omoshore. Nash Richard Pena. Jackson Giordano Pentini. Connor James Port. Yaka Provodnik, cum laude. Madeline Amelia Shaw. Yeah. Ian Bullitt Stimson. King Hung Ken Tom in absentia. Winfred Zhang Wang in absentia. Christopher Kenneth Bruce Weber in absentia. John Matthew Weisgerber. Ethan Scott Welker. J1 Yu. Harry. Xiyue Coco Zhang. Yin Emily Ju, cum laude. I believe I forget to say cum laude for Coco. Oh, it doesn't have it here, Father. William Alexander Zimmerman, cum laude. So if you'll all turn, take the steps and turn. Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you the graduating class of the year of our Lord, 2021. Please be seated. You can go back. I would like to acknowledge that the two members cum laude, Coco, as we heard, and also Jack Weisgerber, who were inducted in the Cum Laude Society. Congratulations. You know, in 17 years, you will hear this sound and you'll remember when you graduated. The cicadas. Yeah. The Holloway Prize Scholarships, endowed in honor of James L. Holloway III, class of 1939, and in memory of James L. Holloway IV, class of 1963, are given to up to two incoming members of the sixth form who have distinguished themselves as scholars, athletes, and examples for good within the St. James community. The prizes are awarded by vote of the faculty, and in order to be eligible, a student must be a varsity athlete in three sports,
have achieved honors or high honors in the fifth form and viewed by the faculty as generally positive and helpful in his or her relationships with other students. The $5,000 scholarship afforded by this endowment is applied towards boarding tuition in the sixth form year, reflecting the Holloway's own experience as boarding students at St. James. The Holloway Prize Scholarship is presented this year to Sean James Rowe, Fairplay, Maryland. The Fields Prize Scholarships, endowed in memory of Ambassador Louis G. Fields, Jr., are awarded to two incoming members of the Sixth Form who have distinguished themselves as scholars, persons of high character and courage, and examples of good within the St. James community. The prizes are awarded by vote of the faculty. In order to be eligible, a student must have achieved honors or high honors in the Fifth Form, participated in a well-rounded program of extracurricular activities, and be viewed by the faculty as generally positive and helpful in their relationships. The $5,000 scholarships afforded by this endowment are applied towards boarding tuition in the sixth form year. They are awarded this year to Chaotu Duan Watkins of Frederick, Maryland, and Sungbum Lee of Gwangju-do, South Korea. The Lee Prize is endowed in honor of Robert E. Lee IV, in recognition of his long service to St. James as trustee, are awarded by vote of the faculty this year to four incoming sixth formers whose earnest endeavor and polite manner make them a particular credit to the society of the school. The $5,000 scholarships afforded by this endowment are applied towards boarding tuition in the sixth form, and they are awarded this year to Sarah Osama Bakker, McLean, Virginia, Levon Paul Girozi, Abidjan, Cote d'Ivoire, Daniel Paul Peacher, Hagerstown, Maryland, and Rodrigo Tejado Gomez Sotomayor, Lidice, Mexico, Jersey City, New Jersey. The following have been appointed sacristans and have been invested for this office in the chapel. As senior sacristan, Sungbum Lee. As senior marshal, Felipe Avellaneda. As senior thurifer, Chaotu Watkins. As sacristans, Philip Aguila, Jack Ashby Jacobs, Elise Bamforth, Lynn Yambaye, Danse Yanu. The senior choristers are Holly Butcher and Sean Rowe. The senior usher is Josephine Akibe. The senior reader is Beatrice Imariagbe. Congratulations. Members of the sixth form, as I told you, met with me, Mrs. McGuigan, Mrs. Fry, and Dr. Regan to look ahead to their future as alumni. The following two members of the graduating class have been appointed class agents, having been elected by their peers. Francine Dayanara Diaz Bonilla, and Warner Thompson Jimmy James III. Congratulations. A As I explained to the school we met last Monday, prefects have a remarkable role at this school, and that they have responsibility as officers of the school to keep their fellow students, you know, on task, happy, and safe. It's not easy, and we really would be greatly diminished without them. And we've been very well served this year by our prefects, I mean, particularly those who've made a real effort. I cite Coco being here all summer so that you could be here in your role. And then again, I'm going to say this, since you won the Bishop's Prize, I can praise you a bit. Also, you know, Jennifer Nguyen, who really wanted to be here, our Vietnamese students, very disappointed that they could not be with us. And really couldn't, just because of government policies. And they, and Coco really found a way to include Jennifer in, as a prefect, in CORE's, as it were, long distance. It was remarkable. Now, a lot of that credit goes to Jennifer, who is just a particularly lovely human being, if we all know her. But very well done, and that's typical of what the prefects have done this year. I think of Jacob and Katie returning to campus. Katie crossed borders just to finish the year with us after their surgeries. And ways in which, you know, I think of, you know, all the prefects, what you have done, the kind of responsibility you've assumed on your floors. We could not have had the kind of community on campus that we have enjoyed without the good work of this year's prefects. So thank you very much. By vote, and so when I call your name, fifth formers, you are no longer fifth formers. You are now sixth formers. So, but when I call your name, if you will come forward and kind of line up below. By vote of the students and faculty, the prefects for the 2021-2022 year are Josephine Edwede Ogor Agbe, Sungbum Lee, Yuxing Lin Chen, who is in China, Daniel Paul Peacher, Sean James Rowe, Rodrigo Tejado Gomez Sotomayor, Paris Alexa Thiele, Chaotu Juan Watkins, and Zachary Maxwell Zanetti. And for those of you who don't know the process, prefects are elected equally by students and faculty in different colleges, and in order to be a prefect, you need to win support in both. It's a remarkable achievement. The senior prefect, who is in charge of the prefect council and the honor council and is the headmaster's prefect, is for the 2021-2022 session is Sean James Rowe. Everyone, we do have lunch, so you can go through and grab a sandwich and, you know, lunch as you feel safe to do so. We would not be a Christian school if we sent you off unfed. And as hospitality is the first of the Christian virtues. And also, I call upon, first of all, the bishop to offer the benediction. Oh, now I have to remind the prefects. The prefects, you need to meet with Mr. Latchett so we can review your immediate plans. Okay, so meet with Mr. Latchett. Where does he like to do it? Behind Claggett. Thank you, Mr. Latchett. If you would do that directly after commencement. And then, I'll ask Bishop Eloff to offer the benediction, and then after the benediction, I will declare the session closed. Bishop Eloff.
Please rise as you are able. Go forth into the world in peace. Be of good courage. Hold fast to that which is good. Render to no one evil for evil. Honor each person as a child of God. Respond to the needs of the poor, put in practice the things that you have learned in this holy place. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with you and remain with you always.
Amen. Amen.
I now declare the session of 2020-2021 to be closed. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.